So Fabio already introduced the technique. I just want to highlight what we are facing today is a schematic view on prognostication after cardiac arrest and the trajectories of those patients. So early on, you may have patients with severe refractory shock and multi-organ failure. Those awakening quite early on, so that's quite easy in terms of prognostication. But then there are patients in whom it may be difficult to separate into what we call irreversible brain damage. So you decide that there are enough negative signs and you withdraw care, or patients with late, so-called late awakening, described in two studies. We published recently one. Patients awakening after 5-7 in our cohort, even 20 days after cardiac arrest. So the question of prognostication, there are guidelines, and obviously guidelines rely on several modalities. So they discuss about multimodal outcome prognostication, and you have electrophysiology, neurological examination, and on top of neurological examination, pupillary reflex, and pupillary reactivity. And you see that the absence, bilaterally absence, of pupillary light reflex is actually associated with poor outcome, and it's a strong sign. So we base our judgments and decisions very strongly on the neurological assessment, and especially pupillary light reflex. The problem with these prognosticators, I try and summarize in this table. You have clinical examination, which is easily available, is a standard, but of course, at least with the standard assessment, is subjective, non-quantitative, you have inter-rater variability and some false positive rates. As for electrophysiology, the problem even with the standard of bad prognostication is that they are not always available and require expertise, and again, they are not quantitative. EEG, there is a debate about the standardization, at least for reactivity. Biomarkers, difficulty with the cutoff, and then the MRI, even if there are very elegant studies. I shall remind you that the quantitative MRI study by Louis Pubasset and Lionel Velli used a quantitative approach, and the timing was beyond 7 days. And so it's still not available in many, many centers. And this then means that the timing for decisions may be delayed, something that there is not really a precise timing. You need individual assessment in the majority. And actually quite a lot of people think that the prognostication still remains uncertain. So the ideal tool would be easily available, automated and quantitative, highly accurate with no false positives, not influenced by individual pupil size, especially if you have sedation and opioids, and not influenced by external factors, especially temperature and again sedation. Do we have such tool? Well, pupillometry is quantitative and could provide us with variables that can be monitored regularly at the bedside. And there are preliminary data from single center studies about the accuracy of quantitative pupillometry. And these studies use the percentage pupillary constriction, so the percentage reactivity. Very early on, so one of the first studies by Behrens and Merlin Larsen was actually during resuscitation in the emergency room. So no recovery of the pupillary constriction was highly associated with poor outcome. There is one Japanese study, and again they performed pupillometry very early on in the first 6 hours, and again absence of pupillary reactivity in terms of the percentage constriction was highly associated with poor outcome. Early, within 48 hours, there are three studies, two from our center, one by Daria Solari, which assessed 1 year neurological outcome, and this is the one I show here, and you see that using the percentage pupillary light reflex, so the percentage constriction using this cutoff, was highly specific and comparable to absent reactivity on DEG and bilaterally absent N20 on the evoked potentials in a cohort of a bit more than 100 patients. Question about percentage pupillary constriction is influenced by sedation, temperature reduction, and opioids. So you can actually use the percentage constriction as a monitor of the depth of sedation. So the advantage of using this index, neurological pupil index, is that it's, let's say, minimally influenced by sedatives and opioids, and it adjusts for individual baseline pupil size, and so the NPY is an index that is adjusted by the changes in sedation, opioids, and pupil size. And so it's supposed to be, although the algorithm is a proprietary algorithm, and so it goes from 0.1 to 4.9, so it has a precision of 0.1 decimal, and it looks promising, especially if you are interested in the outcome of these patients. So that was the basis for this multi-center study that we performed inside the European Society. And the main endpoint was quantitative assessment using the neurological pupil index versus the standard pupillary light reflex, so the standard clinical examination for early prognostication. And of course, the focus is always the bad prognostication in patients with cardiac arrest, comatose, and so we performed across 10 European ICUs that are within the neurointensive care section of the European Society. So it was an investigator-initiated, prospective, multi-center, not sponsored by the company that provides the pupillometers, but was not involved in any part of the study. The test, the pupillometry, and the clinical examination were performed every day, at least once a day, on admission, and then within 24 hours, 48 hours, 72 hours. And the outcome assessor were blinded to pupillometry data. And actually, every center applied several tests. So there was not a standardized protocol for prognostication, but all these 10 centers have expertise in multimodal prognostication. They were all performing examination at least one of the two between EEG and SSCP, and many centers also performed the neuron-specific NLAs. And based on this algorithm for prognostication that we published recently, we required at least two negative tests to withdraw care. So it was based on a local prognostication algorithm. So quantitative NPY was the main endpoint versus manual, the standard assessment, and a 3 months unfavorable outcome prediction. So we were able of including more than 450 patients, and you see the cerebral performance categories at 3 months, so 40% with favorable outcome. This included patients with out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, irrespective of the rhythm and the type of cardiac arrest, which explains somehow the 40%, because there were also systolic and non-cardiac arrest causes. Well, the patient characteristics are quite the same as in this type of group. The majority were treated with a target temperature management of 36, 40% TTM 33. So you see that the majority had shockable rhythms. So the first data is that if you use the NPY versus the percentage pupillary constriction, actually the NPY performs better. This is the reason why we then decided also after this analysis to look predominantly for the NPY. NPY performed at day 1, day 2, day 3, and any time between day 1 and day 3. And the main message of the study is that When you have a cutoff below or equal to 2, there is a 100% prediction of unfavorable outcome. So you are 100% specific with no false positive rate. And this is also very important, is that at day 2 and day 1, the specificity, both the specificity and the sensitivity of the quantitative assessment is significantly higher, you see the P, than the standard. So the manual flashlight. So that's the first method. Highly predictive, better than the standard assessment. And overall, if you are in between day 1 and 3 after cardiac arrest, you perform the NPY using these two cutoff. So this is the abnormal, as recognized by the company. It's still very highly specific, but if you look for zero false positive and 100% specificity, the sensitivity is quite low, but you are extremely accurate and very early on. And you actually are comparable to the somatosensory level potentials, and if you combine the two, that's where you have the highest specificity and highest sensitivity. All right, this is the summary. Is the first message is that NPY is highly predictive. So when you have an NPY between 0 and 2, within day 1 after cardiac arrest, you're 100% specific across 10 centers using temperature of 33, 36, irrespective of sedation because you're at day 1. Secondly, you perform better than the manual assessment. This was significant at day 1 and day 2. And when you combine both pupillometry and EVOC potentials, that's where you are the best. And so in the future, we may introduce pupillometry for prognostication of outcome after cardiac arrest. Thank you.